All right. Well, good morning. It is so good to see each of you this morning. Thank you for those who are here. Thank you for those of us who are joining us online. I know that, we've been off for the last 2 weeks, just online service only, and this is our first in-person service again. And so just want to encourage you. I know that some of you maybe are quarantining. Some of you maybe due to work or different situations, are just taking precautions, and we totally understand that. But we do want to encourage you, if you're healthy, if you're able to, please do continue to join us for our in-person service. So just something about fellowshipping with believers, fellowshipping with one another, and just what comes from that. And so we look forward to that. But again, I just want to say welcome. If you're a guest joining us online, thank you for being with us. My name is Pastor Micah Reed, and I'm the lead pastor here at Chisholm Assembly of God. And so we're excited for this morning. We have missionary Caleb Monson with us this morning. He works for Free International, a ministry that helps to rescue and restore victims of human trafficking. And so you guys know that's something that I'm passionate about as a part of 30 for Freedom and other things that I participate in, and many of you have supported and funded in that way as well. And so we're excited to hear from him and the message that he has for us this morning. And so let's just begin this morning with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity we have to gather together here in the house of the Lord this morning, and those joining us online. We thank you so much, God, that even though sometimes today in our chaotic world we're not able to meet together physically, God, through technology we're still able to stay connected, we're still able to dig into the Word, we're still able to spend time in worship with one another. And so, God, I just pray this morning that no matter where somebody's at that's watching this morning or here in person, God, that you would just pour your Spirit out upon them. God, that you would come and you'd move in a mighty and a powerful way. And God, that they would be changed, challenged, and transformed as a result of this morning and what you're doing in and through each and every one of us. And so, God, we just open ourselves up and say, have your way in our midst this morning. And so we thank you, we love you, we adore you, and we give ourselves to you now. We're going to take a moment now, and we're going to watch our video announcements to see what's coming up here in the next few weeks and month at Chisholm Assembly of God.
Our annual Women's Secret Sister Gift Exchange will be starting in 2 weeks on Sunday, December 6th, and be every Sunday throughout the month of December until the 27th. You must sign up at the church if you want to participate by next Sunday, November 29th, or if you're not able to be here before then, please notify us at the church or let Pastor Laura know you want to participate. The sign-up sheet is in the back of the sanctuary. We'll have our reveal party on Sunday, January 10th. Each Sunday, please have a kind note or a treat or a small gift for your secret sister. Remember, please do not write your name on the gift. Just write the name of your secret sister and then sign secret sister. We look forward to this wonderful time together. At the reveal party on January 10th, everyone will bring a gift of $25 to be exchanged with their secret sister. If you have any questions, please talk to Pastor Laura. We are going to be decorating the church next Sunday, November 29th, following church to get ready for the Christmas season. So if you could please hang around following service to help us set up the trees, lights, different decorations as we come into the Christmas season. We greatly appreciate your help. The more people that are there, the quicker it will go. So we look forward to that wonderful time of fellowship and setting up the church decorations for Christmas next Sunday following service. We will be hosting our annual business meeting in 2 weeks on Sunday, December 6th, following service. We will have the Assistant Superintendent of the Minnesota Assemblies of God District, Doug Graham, with us to celebrate that morning, as we will also be making the transition from a district council church to a general council church. We hope that everyone will join us for this wonderful time as we recap what God did in the church in 2019 and go through the process of making the transition. This is an exciting step for our church. We hope that all of our members will be able to make it to the meeting, and everyone else is welcome to join us as well.
We are excited for our family Christmas service once again this year, and it will take place on Sunday, December 13th. Our nursery, preschool, and elementary age kids will be performing their Christmas numbers as part of the service. Pastor Laura will do a kids moment, and Pastor Micah will do an interactive sermon for the whole family. You won't want to miss out on one of our favorite services of the year. Let's celebrate the joy of Christ's birth together at this special service with all of our friends and family.
Our annual Christmas family service is coming up on Sunday, December 13th. All of our kids in the nursery through fifth grade will be practicing for the program in the kids' classes each Sunday throughout the rest of November and the first Sunday of December if we are meeting in person. The older kids will be doing a number with drums, and our younger kids will be doing a live nativity scene with actions.
Please try to attend as many of these practices as possible on Sundays to be ready for the program. If you would like to receive a digital copy of the song or have any other questions, please talk to Pastor Laura.
I want to, add a little bit to a few of those announcements that we just shared about. Again, if you want to participate in the Women's Secret Sister Gift Exchange, and you're not able to be here this week or next week, but you still want to participate, please reach out to Pastor Laura, reach out to myself, let us know, and we'll get you on the list, and we'll get you your secret sister. And so we want to encourage people to participate in that. Another thing, last week we had started promoting a women's Christmas card and cookie event that was going to take place on Sunday, December 5th, or Saturday, December 5th. We have decided to cancel that just with COVID and just trying to be careful and everything. And so that event is not going to be taking place at this time. And so I want to remind you of that. And so those are just a few of the things we have coming up here. Again, as I said, I haven't been in person with you in almost a month. October 25th was the last time that I was here at the church with everyone. And so we were gone a few weeks with COVID, and we appreciate your prayers. But that was also Pastor Appreciation Sunday. And I just want to say thank you so much to each and every one of you for the thoughtful cards and gifts and just the encouraging words that many of you shared with us. We so appreciate it. I know I speak on behalf of Pastor Brad and Bethany as well when I just say thank you so much for loving on us as your pastors and just showing appreciation. And so we so greatly appreciate that. At this time, we're going to go ahead and we're going to transition into our time of worship. But I just want to encourage you, whether you're here or you're at home, you're at work, wherever you may be, just I want to encourage you to find a space where you can really just get up and begin to freely worship. And so however you're most comfortable with that, we just want to encourage you to enter into a time of worship. So I'm going to pray now as the worship team comes up this morning. Father, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you again, God, that we can gather together in a multitude of different ways. And God, I just pray that as we enter into this time of worship, God, again, that you would just pour your presence. God, I pray that everywhere each person is, God, your Shekinah glory, God, your physical presence, God, would just fall upon each and every person. Just as you led the Israelites out of Egypt with the fire and the cloud, God, I pray today that you would pour that same spirit, that same presence out upon each and every person right where they are this morning. And so, God, we just give ourselves to you and say, Father, have your way in our midst this morning. We thank you and we love you and we appreciate you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, our system is warming up, but we're going to go ahead and we're going to start and follow along as best you can, clap along, dance along, whatever brings you joy and whatever it takes to praise God this morning.
Welcome. You are
sometimes we just have these days where it just seems like no matter what we try to do, it just, nothing seems to work quite right. I think I'm not the only person here, the only person watching online that can relate to the idea that, you know, sometimes you just in some of these funks and you're like, man, why does it seem like despite my best efforts, despite being obedient, it just seems like it's not working, you know? But as we sang today, these last couple songs, it says, God, you are good, good. You are good. And so just, it reminds me that despite when sometimes it seems like we're in this uphill battle and we feel like it's never ending, God, you are good. So I don't know what circumstances you're walking through in your life today, but I know that this year has been a year unlike any other. And many people feel like that's what they've been doing since about March 15th, is walking uphill, and it seems like they're never going to reach that peak and make it to the other side. But I want to encourage you this morning, we serve a good God. We serve a God who's faithful. We serve a God who moves mountains. And as we sang the song, it said, the bridge, I love that it said, I will build my life upon your love, right? Not upon my love that I have, upon God's love that he has for us. That's what I'm building my life upon, is the love he has for us. And it says that it's a firm foundation, right? That love is never changing. It's unending. It's unconditional. It goes with us wherever we go, no matter how far we may wander. God's unconditional love is right there with us. And then it says, I will put my trust in you, and I will not be shaken. Right? And so, God, I just pray this morning that for each and every one of us, that, God, we would put our trust in you alone and nowhere else. That we wouldn't put it in the promises of this world, that we wouldn't put it in all the things that culture tries to tell us are the ways we should handle difficult circumstances in our life, or even how we should celebrate the victories that we have in our life. But God, that we would put our trust in you alone, that God, we wouldn't be shaken, that firm foundation that's built upon the love that you have for us. May we stand strong, may we not be shaken, may we not be pulled to the right or to the left, but God, may we stay in the center of what you are asking each and every one of us to do. God, we are so grateful for the love that you have for us. That despite our sin, despite our imperfections, despite our disobedience, despite, God, all these things, you love us still. And we thank you for that, Lord, for your grace and your mercy that you have for us. And God, I pray today that some of us could have just been encouraged and reminded of the love that God has for us. And the foundation that's built upon the love that he poured out for us. When he created the whole world, when he created everything, he had a plan, and that was to pour his love out upon each and every person. That's why we were created, to be loved and have a relationship with our Creator, with God. Father, as we get ready now in a moment to transition into our time of hearing from our missionary guest, Caleb, and about the ministry he's a part of, and also having a challenging word this morning. God, I just pray you just open up each of our hearts and our minds to hear and receive from you this morning exactly what you have, exactly what the Holy Spirit would have for each and every one of us. So God, I just pray anointing upon Caleb and what he's about to share and the word that you have given him for us and our congregation, our community today. Lord, we love you, we adore you, and we give thanks to you that you are good, that you are loving, that you are faithful, that God, you are never changing. We thank you. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Just real quick before I have Caleb come up and share with us this morning, you may be seated at this time. If you haven't taken care of your tithes or offerings at this time, I would encourage you to do so following service, or if you're joining us online, you can do so at www.chisholmag.com, and at the end of the service, we will also be receiving a love offering. And so if you give online, please do designate it, regular tithe, missions giving. I added a new tab now that's guest speaker, so today, if you want to participate and give towards Caleb and the ministry that you're calling him to, you can designate that as well. And so some of you guys know, as I mentioned earlier, I've been a part of 30 for Freedom for 4 years now, I believe it is. I've participated in it. And that's one thing Caleb and I have in common. Would have been last year, 2019, Caleb ran the full 30 mile, just like I had done in 2018. You know, so we've got a common understanding of the pain that comes with running a 30 mile ultra marathon. Caleb just has such a passion to see victims of human trafficking not only find freedom, but to be restored and to find wholeness and find healing and redemption and be able to figure out the next steps of how to continue to move forward. And I know he's going to share more about that and Free International that he works with. And so, Caleb, at this time, if you could come up and share with us this morning.
Thank you, Pastor Micah. And it's great to be with all of you this morning, both in person and online. I'm so glad that you are joining me one way or another. But like Pastor Micah says, I'm a missionary to victims of human trafficking, and I'm going to get into that in a little bit here, just about what exactly that looks like. But before I get too far into it, I want to encourage you to, when we're done with service, meet me at my table, and I have these awesome prayer cards for every one of you. So if you are joining us in person, I'd love for every person to have a prayer card of mine in your Bible, on your fridge, wherever you need to put it, on your bathroom mirror, whatever works for you. Because I want a group of people in Chisholm consistently praying for the ministry we do. I want a group of people in Minnesota that say consistently, daily, whatever works like, what it looks like for you to be consistently praying for the ministry we do as we go and find victims of human trafficking, as we go and restore and bring them life change and freedom, as Pastor Michael was talking about. But this morning, as we talk about this issue of human trafficking, more specifically sex trafficking this morning, As I say that phrase to you this morning, every one of us in the room has a different idea and a different glimpse of what you think that looks like. But like in your mind, what you think trafficking looks like is probably very different than somebody across the room this morning. Why? Because every one of us has gotten our education, if you'll say, from a different source. You see, some of us has gotten our 4-year degree in human trafficking from Facebook.com, am I right, anyone? Like everything you see on Facebook has to be true because it says human trafficking on it, so it has to be right. And some of us, maybe you've got your education from the Taken movies, like all three of them. Anyone watch all three of them, maybe? Anybody? No one's willing to admit it, all right. But some of you have seen those movies, and I know for a fact, but the movies about Taken are all about the issue of human trafficking and finding, I believe, his daughter or someone that's missing. I haven't really seen them, to be honest. But as we talk about this issue and the problem that we have in this country, every one of us has a different idea of what it is. But what I want to tell you this morning is probably the idea of what the issue is probably not even close to what's happening in the world today. So I want to take some time this morning and take you from wherever you are about knowing about this issue and take you closer to where it really is happening and what's really going on in this issue. And this morning I want you to think about how many decisions you've already made up to this point. How many choices you've already made up to this point at 10:58 in the morning. Some of you decided what time to wake up. You set your alarm last night and it woke you up on time. And some of you have kids, and so they decided what time you woke up this morning. Am I right? Anyone with young kids can understand how that goes. And maybe for you, maybe you set an alarm and it didn't go off and you overslept and you're joining us on live stream. And hey, we're glad you're with us even still. And decisions even beyond that of what to wear this morning. Some of you decided to dress warm, and some of you are still wearing t-shirts, and I don't know how you're doing it, but winter's coming, and you're still holding out, right? And some of you, again, on live, I don't know what you got going on over there, but I'm still glad you're with us. But we all decided what to wear this morning. And thank goodness every one of us wore clothes. Thank you to everyone in person. I really appreciate that. But all these are for decisions, or even a different decision that many of us made this morning is whether or not to have coffee this morning. And when you grab your coffee, did you take it black, add cream, add sugar? Or if you're like me, I made the mistake of making hotel coffee, which was absolutely terrible. And then I ended up going to McDonald's anyways and getting a different coffee. But I want you to think, as I talk about all these different simple things that we take for granted, all these different things that you probably didn't even think about too hard this morning. But I want you to imagine this morning having made no decisions up to this point. I want you to imagine this morning that you don't get to make any of your own choices, any of your own decisions today at all. Even the decisions like where you will sleep tonight, even what city you will be in by the end of today, even the decisions of what you will wear today, when or if you will eat today, and even the decision of how many clients you must have by the end of tonight. Many in larger cities, even smaller towns, are sold 10 to 15 times a day. Every day of the week, it doesn't matter if it's Christmas or Easter or Thursday, every day of the week, their life is the same as they are sold 10 to 15 times a day, every night. You see, as we look at decisions, many of us take them for granted. Many of us think that, you know, everybody in the world gets to make these basic decisions, but what I began to discover as I got involved in this issue was that for too many people, their decisions are made for them. They don't get to say yes or no to who they will sleep with tonight. They are told they must sleep with any paying customer. They don't get to say yes or no if they will even, if you want to call it work, if they will work today. You see, every day is a work day for them. And as we look at this issue, and many of us, again, coming in this morning, you have this idea of what trafficking looks like. We think of white vans and semis going down interstates. We think of zip-tied windshield wipers, which went all over Facebook for no reason, as being a sign of trafficking, which it wasn't. We think of the Wayfair conspiracy that broke news 3 months ago that wasn't even true. You see all these misconceptions of what trafficking is, but reality is what I just told you about decisions, about choices. Reality is as kids as young as 5, kids as young as maybe 7, it's kids in our own communities in Chisholm, in Hibbing, in any community in this country, it's happening. You see, it's a story of way too many victims in our world, often estimated at 40 million slaves in our world today. You see, I remember sitting in history class in 8th grade, and you guys maybe as well, some of you it was a couple years ago. But as you sat in history class, we all got told, and it was probably a test question, what year was slavery abolished? And if you answered 1865, you got the answer right. What I want to tell you is that answer is not correct. You see, slavery has never been truly abolished. It just changed forms. It's no longer the slavery as we imagined it was before of African Americans. It's now the slavery of children, of women, and our own country. They're our own citizens, they're our neighbors, they're the kids that you see in your classrooms as you teach. They're the kids that you see walking down the street, and they're the kids that you don't even know that it's going on, but it's their life. You see, a little bit of my story this morning for you. As I stand up here and talk about this issue, people wonder, how did you get involved in this? Like, what got you so passionate? I want to tell you very briefly. I grew up in a great Christian home. I grew up in a small town in Wadena, Minnesota, which is about 3 hours, whatever direction from here. And it's a town of about 4,000 people, a phenomenal school, high school that I went to, teachers that cared about you, coaches that really cared about your life, that poured into you consistently. I was involved in sports and activities and everything that I could be. I had a phenomenal childhood. And many people, I often say this, other people will tell you they had great Christian homes and they had the best Christian parents, but I'm telling you mine were better. It's just reality. But my parents were phenomenal. I got to see a set of parents that lived their faith on Tuesday the same way that they did on Sunday. I got to see a set of parents that didn't just do the thing to check it off the list for an hour and a half on Sunday morning, but waking up early on a random morning, I'd catch my dad in the living room reading his Bible. Or when my mom was making lunch for us as we were kids, having worship music on as she worshiped in the middle of making lunch. You see, that was my childhood. And I want to give you a free sermon point that has nothing to do with where I'm going this morning, but if you have kids, if you have neighbor kids, if you are a grandparent, if you have any kids that have any access to your life, I want to challenge you, don't live your Christian faith on Sunday mornings and forget about it the rest of the time. You see, I was a youth pastor for 3 years. before getting into this ministry, and I would see the Christian families on Sunday morning as they drug their kids into church, and they put on this great show, but then I would see that same kid on Wednesday night and hear the stories of what's going on at home. And hear what really is happening. I want to challenge you, if you're a parent or anything that I listed, if you're a grandparent, maybe live your faith all the way throughout the week. Maybe show your kids or your grandkids what it really looks like to live for God. Because what happens on Sunday isn't what impacts your children's lives as much as what happens on Thursday. So I want to challenge you with that. If you would consider living your Christian faith all the way throughout. But back to my message this morning. As I had this great Christian family, I had a great experience. I graduated high school with this a view of the world that it was a pretty good place. Like the world, I knew there were bad things that happened and whatever, but for the most part, the world is a pretty good place is the view that I had. And I want to tell you today, I'm not quite as optimistic as I look at the world and the ministry that I do. But I remember going to Master's Commission in Cold Spring and the ministry school that I went to and having this documentary played for us in about November of my first year there, so about 2 or 3 months in. And this documentary plays out in very vivid detail of what trafficking really looks like in our lifetime. And this was the first experience back in 2014 that I really had with the idea of trafficking existing. You see, the media wasn't talking about it 6 years ago. It wasn't on social media 6 years ago like it is now. Why? Because it's this big hot button issue right now, which is great. But back then, in 2014, all 6 years ago, it wasn't. And for me, coming out of a great Christian family of a small town, having this thrown in my face of a reality in our world, I absolutely wept at the end of this documentary. I'm not an emotional guy. I'm really not. But as I watch this documentary, I'm weeping at the idea that we live in a world where we have women and children being sold miles away from where we live. And I'm weeping at the idea of like who is doing something about this issue? Who is actually finding these victims? And for many people, the answer is no one. No one was doing anything at that point, and even still today, there's not enough being done. And then about a year ago, I guess it's almost 2 years now, I was in Vegas on a mission trip with the organization that I'm with now, and as I walk into a massage parlor, where victims are being trafficked 24 hours a day. And I walk into this massage parlor and we're handing out these compassion gifts to help these girls out, really just to give them a glimmer of hope in their life. But also while we're doing that, gathering intel for law enforcement. And as I'm in there and I'm talking to this girl, she's probably young 20s. She doesn't even know what city she's in. She doesn't speak very good English. She's probably from China or a country over there in this case. And as we try to converse with her, she tries to put on this great show of how happy she is, how great it is to see you because she thinks you're a customer, and, oh, well, I'll get you in for a massage right away, which really isn't what was going to happen behind the closed door. And as I'm talking to this woman, again, first time experiencing looking a victim eye to eye, hearing stories, reading statistics is different than when you speak to a victim eye to eye. And as they put on this show of being happy, of loving their life, and oh yes, I'd love to give you a massage, you look in their eyes, and their eyes tell you something very different. You see, the eyes can't play a story. The eyes, you see the sorrow. You see the absolute no hope in their life. Why? Because they've probably lived in this massage parlor for the last however many months, and 24 hours a day, and the man that walks in there pays and does whatever they want to that victim. And this girl that puts on a show of being happy to see somebody walk in, that's not her story. Her story is that she followed a false promise. She was taken. She was brought to that massage parlor, and that is where she would live her life. Never leaving, sleeping there, eating there when they choose to feed them, and then to be sold. And as we look at this issue, as my heart broke, and I want to talk about some statistics this morning, and as we look at statistics, I'm going to tell you they're just really good guesses. We don't really know how bad the issue really is. But we can take some good guesses, but we always believe it's probably worse. We always believe it's probably a little bit worse than what it really is. And a couple of statistics for you this morning is every 30 seconds somebody is sold into trafficking. For the very first time, I'm not talking about the 10th time they're sold today after 5 years of being trafficked. I'm saying the first time a young child is victimized for the first time, every 30 seconds. At this point, We've been sitting in service for almost an hour, about 57 minutes or something like that. Over 114 children and women have been sold since we've been sitting here this morning. Since you've been sitting on your couch joining us online, that's the story. The average age for a victim in the U.S. at least is 12 years old for girls and 11 years old for boys. The reality of averages is that means there's a lot younger in that number. There's a lot younger victims in that number. I want to ask you this morning, do you know anyone that age in your life? Maybe you don't have a kid that age, but you know someone that does. Maybe your neighbor's kid. Maybe a kid in your classroom as you teach. Maybe whoever it is in your life, maybe it's a nephew or a niece that age. But can you imagine if it was one of them? Can you imagine if it was one of them? Because when we make it personal, it changes our hearts a little bit. When we make it personal, if it was an actual person that we know, if it was one of them, it changes the way we look at the issue. It's no longer an issue somewhere else. It's no longer an issue for somebody else to deal with. Again, 12 years old, 11 years old for boys, and on average, yearly, again, this is a guesstimate, $150 billion is made in this industry, this crime industry, $150 billion. The U.S., again, we think it's somebody else's problem. I could ask anyone in this country today, is trafficking happening in Thailand? And every one of them would look me in the eyes and say, yes, we know that. I could ask those same people, is trafficking happening in Cambodia? Every one of them would say, yeah, we know that. But you know how many people look at me in the eye and say, trafficking isn't happening in the U.S.? I want to tell you, you're wrong. The U.S. is always the top three worst countries for trafficking. We're always in the top three, moving between two, one, and three. We're always moving, but we're always in the top three. Minnesota, as I'm personally based out of Minnesota, as we fight this issue locally and throughout the U.S., Minnesota is in the top 10 worst states. And this morning, as you're sitting here thinking about this issue, if you're like me when I first kind of heard about this issue, you might be sitting here feeling a bit overwhelmed. A bit challenged, maybe. A bit kind of like, what do we do about this issue with 40 million victims in the world today? And I want to tell you this morning that as we look at this issue, in our organization, we followed this quote from one of our team members pretty closely. And the quote goes, one is a very big number. The number one is a very big number. Why? Because who is the next one that we're going to rescue this week? Because if we focus on 40 million, it's easy to get a little defeated. But this week, who's the next one? As earlier this week, we rescued one in Mississippi that's now being placed in a shelter. So who's the next one after that? And that's what we focus on. Really quick, I want to go through what we do specifically in this fight, and then I'll get into my actual sermon piece of it. But with Free International, we do a lot of different things, but the four things that I focus on in the organization, number one is our massage parlor outreach. I lead our intel team for our organization across the country as we gather massage parlor intel. Massage parlors just like this are a reality all across this country, any major city. I didn't check Hibbing, I'm not sure of the actual area this morning, but I could go to any city over 10,000 and almost guarantee there's a massage parlor in that city. The reality of what I already told you, victims being sold in those places. And as we go in and gather intel for law enforcement, they're able to do their investigations after that, and actually we get to see some of the places shut down. So I lead that for our organization as we see victims set free from that. If you want to go to the next slide this morning, this is a text message from one of our outreaches that we did in Vegas last year. As we reach victims through texting and online stuff, because these victims, even especially with COVID, are being sold online a whole lot more than they already were. And if you can read this message, if you're online, I'll read it for you. But the first message that comes back as we reach out to these victims being sold online is, I need help, with about 10 exclamation points behind it. And I know for you, if I were to send you a text and you didn't really know me that well, you don't know what emotion I'm sending it with, right? You get to interpret how you want to interpret it. You don't know if I'm super happy or super mad, or you don't know, but I want you to imagine this morning, a young woman never meeting somebody on the other end of the line that's texting her. And she doesn't know who we are, but simply saying, I need help, with 10 exclamation points. Can you imagine the desperation? Can you imagine being in such a vulnerable spot where you're like, I don't know who you even are, but I know that you might help me. And then the following response that we get from her after offering her some help says, "Can someone pick me up? Is there anyone out there that can pick me up?" And as I read this text as it came through on one of our burner phones, I imagine this is the anthem of 40 million people echoing throughout the world this morning. Can someone help me? Is there anyone, as they are waking up soon after being sold all night last night, is anyone going to help me in this world that we live in today? Is there anyone that even notices me? Is there anyone that even sees I'm missing? Is there anyone doing anything? And that's the passion that we drive in this issue of, can we go find one more person? If you want to go to the next slide this morning, we'll go through a couple of these pretty quick, but we have two of these mobile command units on our team right now, and you'll notice a really big Speed the Light logo on the back of that. Also, to backtrack a little bit, the cell phones and computers for our previous outreach that I talked about is BGMC funded. So I always try to push that. Why? Because when you're buying a $30 pie that you could have made for $5, this is what it does. When kids are coming up to you and saying, "Hey, would you help fill my buddy barrel," or whatever you do at this church, you're helping victims be reached. So I want to challenge you, when you get burned out on those things, I want to tell you we're forgetting the Great Commission when we burn out on those issues. But as we take these units, and we're supposed to be getting one in Minnesota shortly, as we go throughout the country looking for missing kids, you can go to the next slide. This is part of our big search outreach as we print these flyers in any major city that we're looking at, and then the next slide. On the inside of those booklets would be these faces. And every time we go into a major city and look for the top 30 missing kids that are missing, we have this banner or this board in our command center. And I want to tell you, when we get to cross off one of those names, when we get to write the word "located" across one of those kids' descriptions, I want to tell you there's a celebration in those mobile command units as we just found one more kid. And then a couple hours later, we'll find another kid. Usually, any major city will find 15 to 25 kids in a week that have been missing for 2 years sometimes. People ask, how do you find them? We simply look for them. Many of these kids, no one's looking. And then the last thing, and then I'll get into my message this morning quickly. In the next slide is a picture before COVID, clearly. There's way too many kids in that gym these days. But we do school assemblies across the country as we speak about trafficking. And the cool thing about our school assemblies is, as an organization, we've had more rescues from our school assemblies on gym floors and in school hallways than we have any other way. Many people think in order to rescue victims, you have to beat doors down and go in like whoever you want to imagine, some celebrity. But for us, we find more victims in our high schools. Why? Because kids are being trafficked in every one of our high schools. They just don't know it. And so we are all about going and finding them. We're hoping next year we're able to get back in the schools. But this morning, as I talk about this issue, I want to tell you, you have a responsibility in this fight. You have an opportunity in this fight, and I want you this morning to turn with me to Matthew 25, and if you don't have your Bible or whatever, it'll be on the screen, but I'm probably going to paraphrase it anyways. But Matthew 25, but before you go there, you can go there, but I'm going to look at Matthew 28 really briefly. Many of you know this verse, and many of you should. If you don't, you should like write it on your fridge this week and memorize it. Matthew 28 is the Great Commission. And it says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." And as I look at this passage of the Great Commission, the passage that we kind of base our churches on, which we should, The passage that almost every missionary is probably going to preach at you anytime they come in, you can almost you almost already know. But as we look at this verse of the Great Commission, I want you to think about this. There's no exception to the Great Commission. There's no like exclusions to the Great Commission. As it says, "Therefore, go and make disciples," I don't see any spots where it says, "If you are a pastor, go and make disciples." I don't see any part in there where it says, "If you are old, go and make disciples," because we're too young, we're busy, we're working jobs, we have kids to raise. So therefore, if you are older and retired, then you have to go and make disciples, but I don't. And then we're going to flip the script. If we are a little older, We like to say, if I was younger, then I would go and make disciples because they have energy, they have time, whatever, they know technology. Another one, if I was introverted, then I could go and make disciples. I know this seems odd, right? If you don't know, I'm extroverted. You can't tell. But if I was introverted, then I could make disciples because they have really close relationships. They can lead small groups really well. And they just know people on a deeper level. I don't know how to do like real conversations with people sometimes, right? And then if we're introverted, let's flip the script a little bit. And I'm sure you guys are catching on now. But if I was extroverted and I could preach a message and I could stand in front of people, then I could make disciples. You see, as I look at the Great Commission, every one of us has excuses. If I had more money, then I could make disciples. If I have read through the Bible 3 times, then I can go and make disciples. Whatever excuse, and I want you to think this morning, what excuse does each of us have that we use? Because I'm telling you, every one of us, even as a pastor, as a missionary, we all have reasons of why last week I didn't make any disciples. Because I was busy. Because I was doing other stuff. Like what excuse do we have? And this morning, like I said, I'm going to summarize it, but Matthew 25, starting in verse 14, it's the parable of the bags of gold. And many of you, if you've been in church, you know this passage, but I'm going to summarize it for you. And I want to tell you this morning, it has nothing to do with wealth, so if you're like, I don't have money so I can fall asleep on the couch. No, you're still a part of this kid. In the parable of the bags of gold, it starts out with a man going on a journey. And he calls his servants and says, I have this wealth that I need to entrust to you as I leave and go on this journey. So I want you to use my wealth and build wealth with it. And I'll come back one day and we'll settle up on it. And the passage goes on to say, and I'd recommend you reading it later on your own, but it goes on to say, one man gets 5 bags, one man gets 2 bags, and one man gets 1 bag of gold. And as we follow this verse, then the master comes back. And he first meets with a man of 5 bags of gold. He says, hey, I gave you 5 bags of gold. What does it look like? What is your portfolio, your 401k, whatever you want to imagine it being? And he says, Master, I knew you were a man that harvested where you had not sown. And he says, so I went out and I invested it. I worked hard and I built it. And you gave me 5 and I come back with 10. I doubled it. That's pretty good returns, right? And the master says, well done, good and faithful servant. And then it goes on to the man with 2 bags of gold, and the exact same thing where he says, you gave me 2 bags, and I come back, and I have 4. I doubled it. I worked hard. And the master says, well done, good and faithful servant. But then as we look at the man with 1 bag of gold, it says, Master, I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown, gathering where you have not scattered seed. So in verse 25, it says, so I was afraid, and I went out, and I hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. 26, his master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. You knew that I harvest where I have not sown, and I gather where I have not scattered seed. You should have put my money in deposit with the banker, so in return, could have received it back with interest. And in verse 28, he takes the bag of gold from him. And in verse 30, it says, throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, for there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And I look at this passage, and you see 3 servants that are treated very differently. You see 2 that come back and say, Master, I did what you asked me. I doubled what you gave me. I invested. I did good things. And then you see the man that says, I was afraid. I didn't do anything with it. I stuck it in the ground. Here's your 1 bag of gold that's probably all dirty and rusty, and the bag is falling apart, but here it is. I'll give it back to you. And I wanted to ask you this morning, as I'm kind of talking about the idea of being a difference maker. You see, every one of us in our life has a passion to make a difference around us. I don't think any of us wants to end our life and say, I didn't do anything with my life and I'm so happy. No, every one of us wants to get to the end of our life and say, I made a difference. I impacted people. I coached softball. I impacted teams. I worked hard. I made jobs for people. Whatever your story is of how you made a difference. You see, difference makers, as I define it, give up the time, talents, and even resources on behalf of someone or something else. And I want to change this idea this morning from bags of gold to the keys in your pocket to make it a little more applicable to today. Because I don't have any bags of gold. I don't know if you do, but if you do, we should talk. But if you have a set of keys in your pocket, You see, every one of us, if I take my set of keys and try to start the nicest car in the parking lot, it won't start. Just reality, right? And your set of keys won't start somebody else's car, and if it does, you might have a problem. But I want you to think about spiritually, God has given every one of us keys. Every one of us has a very different key spiritually. You see, some of you, if you try to be like Bethany, and you try to come up here and play the piano, it's going to be a really bad time, right? And you know who you are, that's me. Right? You see, maybe that's her spiritual key, that she leads worship, right? Some people raise their hands, you get it. But your key is very different. You see, every one of us has different God-given abilities, and for those of you watching live, this applies to you just as much. You see, this church, God sent specific people to it. Specific people were sent to this church. Why? Because God knew what this church needed. God knew what people needed to be here, and some of you aren't using your keys. You see, I worry that some of us take, say, God, thank you for this key, but I'm just going to stuff it in my pocket, and we're just going to leave it there. Or maybe I'm going to bury it in my backyard because then really we can't find it, and then I don't have to do what God asked me to do. But I want to ask you this morning of what are the talents and abilities that God has given you? Because they're needed at this church. They're needed in this community. And then some of us say, you know, I can't preach a message. Like, that's not my thing, so I'm not gifted. Or I can't lead worship, so I'm not gifted, and so God doesn't really need me. But I want to talk briefly about when I was a pastor for 3 years, again, at a church, one of my favorite volunteers was the guy that had recently retired, and we needed somebody to cut the grass because we had like a couple acres of mowing to do, right? We had a big softball field and all this different stuff. And for one of us pastors to do it, it took like 6 hours of our week when we had to do other stuff. And I love mowing grass, but sometimes you have other stuff to do. And we asked this guy named Mike and said, hey, we heard you might like cutting grass. Would you want to help us out? He said, we have sandy soil, so just cut it once every 3 weeks. That'll be okay. We don't got to worry about it. And he looks me in the eye and says, can I cut it every week, with a smile on his face? You see, that was his key in the kingdom, was cutting the grass and making our grass the nicest grass in town. Why? Because that was his gift back to the church. And I want to ask you this morning, what are the keys that you aren't using? Well, what are the things that God says, I want you to do this in the church or in the community, but I'm too afraid to? And some of us, our keys might change over time. You might ask, how do they change? Well, our experiences. You see, the things that we've been through in life change the key that we have. I tell the story of my parents lost a set of twins stillborn between my older sister and my older brother a couple of years before me. And as they walked through that horrific time of grieving, of having a funeral for a set of twins, of burying their set of twins, God did not intend that in no way. But what I tell people is they are able to minister to people that are going through that in a way that I can't. Right? Like, I don't have any experience. I don't have any ability to give empathy into that in a serious way. But my parents can walk beside anyone in our church and be like, we've been through this. We can sit here with you. And maybe for you, you've struggled with alcoholism all your life, and you're at a spot where you've defeated it. And you can walk beside somebody in this community and say, hey, I know you're struggling, but can I just sit beside you? Can I walk beside you in this? You see, I want you to realize there's people in this community that Pastor Micah can never reach. I know you think it's crazy, like that's what we pay a pastor to do, right? He's supposed to reach everyone in the community. But I want to tell you, there's people in this community that Pastor Bethany and Brad, they can't reach. Why? Because you've been through what this person is struggling with. You can speak into it. You can say, hey, I know you're struggling with financial issues. One time I went through bankruptcy, and I can help you and then walk you through the struggle. Like there's so many different things that you don't think God wants to use. But maybe that's exactly what your spiritual key is. And then another thing, as I'm closing, getting closer to closing, I want to briefly touch on this morning as we look at the key that we have. And I want to talk to a little older generation in this church, and I'm not going to say who's older and who's not. You get to decide, okay? If you're watching on live, you as well. But I want to talk to the a little bit older generation, the people that have walked with God for 30, 40 years, 20, whatever your story is. I look at other believers, and many people in my generation are asking this question. We know that there's a God of power. We know that you say that there's a God of miracles, and I'm just talking about my generation, okay? We know that you say that this God of miracles, a God of power, a God that does things today. But we're asking, where is the stories? But like, we know that you say that God heals, but where's the story? But like, you say that you've seen it happen, but what I'm getting at this morning is my generation needs your generation to share your stories. To say, hey, this was 30 years ago, but we still need to hear it today. Of the time when you saw physical healing in front of you. Of the time when you saw God show up and you had no money, but there was food on your table and it never ran dry. Of the times when you had marriage issues that you thought you were on the verge of divorce, but God came through and healed your marriage. We need those stories, people. Why? Because that's what lifts my faith. That's what lifts my generation to say, okay, there is a God of miracles. There is a God of power. We need to see those in our churches. And this morning, as I look at this idea of maybe you have a key in your pocket, and you don't know how to use it. You say, I know that I'm supposed to do something, Pastor Caleb, but I just don't know how. Like, I don't know how to, like, actually use what God's given me. I want to challenge you this week to take your spiritual set of keys and put it in Pastor Micah's hand. Or Pastor Brad, or whoever you need to talk to and say, I don't know how you want to use this, but this is my set of keys. Why? Because every church, every pastor has a dream inside of them from God that they want to see fulfilled through their church that they can't do yet because they don't have the right person, because they don't have the right people. And why do I know this? I was a pastor for 3 years in the church. Like, maybe you're the answer to Pastor Micah's prayer for the last 3 years that he hasn't been able to see happen yet. But would you go to Pastor Micah this week or whoever you need to and say, how can you use me? Because I think too often there's too many people in our churches that come on Sundays or they watch live online. And then at 11:30, we're done, so now I'm good until next Sunday. And then next week, it's the same thing. We come in for the hour and a half service, and then check it off. I'm good for the next week. But we're called to invest. We're called to make a difference. We're called to see things happen. So this morning, I want to ask you, what's your key? What's your key in this community, in this church, and then lastly, in the fight of human trafficking? Really, really quick. Four ways that we need your help in the fight of human trafficking. Why? Because as I said earlier, every one of us has a responsibility and a duty to fight this issue. Not a single one of us says that's somebody else's issue. Why? Because when it's an issue that breaks God's heart, we're called to fight it. Like, I don't believe that we're just called to say, well, I'm not called to fight the human trafficking issue, so I'm good. I'm going to go to lunch. I'm set. This morning, four ways. One, and one of the most important, is we need prayer. We go into some situations, both physical safety, emotional, spiritually, all the different stuff. We need prayer warriors behind us that wouldn't say, okay, I'll pray for you at lunch today and then I'm good. But it would say weekly or daily, I will get on my knees and pray for you as you fight this issue. The second thing is this. We need financial support. I know it's a reality of every missionary, but maybe for you, God is saying, I'm calling you to use your financial ability to impact this issue. Being a monthly partner at any level that you can. And then the third, I know I said there was four, but we're going to just do three this morning, is this. I want to challenge you and challenge our churches to change culture a little bit. To look at this issue and change the culture around us, because, as I said, I don't know how we live in a world where buying other human beings is okay. I don't know how we have a culture in America and in this world that says other human beings are for sale. But some of us sit at work and we hear our buddies talking about the idea that they're going to go buy somebody this weekend. And you're not participating, but you know it's happening. Would you stand up against that? Would you say it's not okay? Would we raise our kids to say that this culture is not okay? And then the other thing is this. Some of us, you might not realize it, but the content that you're viewing online, I want to challenge this morning. You see, you're viewing content online, and many of us that are adults, you know what I'm talking about, the stuff that we should not be viewing. And as we view those videos online, I want to challenge you in this. You're doing two things. One, the people in those videos are victims of human trafficking. The people in the videos that we're viewing are victims of human trafficking. And the other reality is this. As that content grows, as that content gets watched more and more, it makes our issue even harder. Why? Because more people are out buying other human beings. And as I'm out here every day of the week fighting this issue of human trafficking, the reality is I'm fighting against some of the very people in our own churches. Why? Because they're propelling the issue. They're promoting this content. They're watching it in their secret time. And I want to tell you, I'm not here to shame you. I'm not here to do any of that. I just want to challenge you this morning. Would you step out and ask for some help? Would you say, Pastor Mike, I'm struggling with this. It's something I'm trying to kick, and I just can't do it because when I get lonely, it's just the first thing I turn to. When I get bored, it's the first thing I turn to. And I want to challenge you, if you're watching online, if you're in here today, would you take the step this week and say, I don't want to turn to that anymore. I want to be beyond that. And I'm going to close in prayer, and then I'm going to hand it over to Pastor Micah as he was going to close this out. But Lord, I want to pray this morning to you as we come before you with this heavy issue. With this issue all around us that we don't even know that is happening within miles of where we're at this morning. That you would tell us this morning what is our key in this community, in this church, and in the fight of human trafficking, Lord. And that we would not defer it to somebody else. That we would not say somebody else can fight this issue because I just want to stick my head in the sand. But Lord, you would call us to what we're called to do in this fight, Lord. In your name, amen.
Thank you, Caleb, for sharing that with us today. I think as I was just listening, as he closed, you know, as he said it, it is such a heavy topic when we think about human trafficking, especially sex trafficking. But it just, I went through this whole wide range of emotions throughout the whole time he was speaking. Right? Sometimes when you first start hearing about it, and you know, I know a decent amount, but you know, there was a lot that I gleaned statistically, and as he explained it even this morning, sometimes you get frustrated thinking, how do we have people in our world that think that's okay, right? And that's their livelihood. That's the way that many of them are very prosperous in what they do in that area of their life. You know, and then as you get that compassion of thinking, God, give me your heart to see the hurting and the broken. We talk about that all the time. God, I want to give us the eyes to see like you do, that we can see the brokenness in the world around us. And as he said, another thing that broke my heart is as he talked about, you know, they have those banners and the booklets with the kids. Why does no one find them? Because quite frankly, there's no one looking for them. And that's the kind of stuff that you hear and you're like, how? How, that's not okay. And who has to pick up that mantle? As the church, we do. As a church, that's our job to say, you know what? There is a lot of things we need to work on and a lot of ministries we can be a part of. But man, if we ignore this one, if we say, no, this is for other people to take care of, as Caleb said, I think we've totally missed the point. We've missed the gospel. We've missed what Jesus was trying to teach us about when he walked on this earth and what all the rest of Scripture teaches us. And so this morning as we close out, we're going to receive an offering this morning for Caleb and his wife Brittany and Free International, the ministry that they're a part of. And I just want to encourage you this morning, not trying to guilt you in any way, shape, or form, but just earnestly say, God, what is it that you want me to do? As he talked about, what are the keys? You know, many of us, you know, we can all pray. Absolutely. Every single one of us, even if you're not here today, we're going to keep a stack of prayer cards. And I pray that when you come back the next time you're here, you'll grab one of the prayer cards off our missions table and begin to continue to pray for them. But many of us, we can also financially support. We can financially partner. And that doesn't necessarily mean maybe a monthly commitment, but God can give you a number or an idea of what it is that you can sacrifice. I didn't say give freely, sacrifice. That's what giving is. It's a sacrifice. It's saying, you know what, instead of going out to eat after church today, I'm going to take that $40 my family would have spent and I'm going to put it in the offering. And so this morning as we receive this offering, just I want you to earnestly seek God and say, God, what would you like me to do today with this opportunity to support Caleb and the ministry they're a part of? But God, also, what other things could I do to partner with them? Could I become a monthly supporter? Could I be someone who is an advocate for, you know, fighting against human trafficking in our area and changing that culture in Chisholm and around the Iron Range? And so this morning, Father, we just thank you again for this challenging message that you've brought to us through Caleb. God, both informational and informative when it comes to the ministry of Free International and why it exists and what the humongous need for it is. But God, also the challenge from your word that, God, you've given each of us keys, talents, gifts, abilities, resources. Are we fully utilizing them? Or are we holding on to them, putting them in our pocket, or as you said, burying them in the ground and just saying, well, if I don't see it, if I don't think about it, if I ignore it, maybe it'll just go away. God, you haven't called us to live like that. You've called us to seek you with our whole heart. You've called us to run after the ministry that you placed before us. And so, God, I pray this morning that you would bless Caleb and Brittany and the ministry, that you'd bless Free International. God, I pray you'd give them favor and anointing everywhere they go. God, I pray that in his specific one of his roles of being an intel gatherer with the massage parlors, God, I pray you would just give Caleb such an insight, God, such an understanding that's far beyond his, but it's through the Holy Spirit, God, that you would just, God, give him wisdom. Give him open doors. Give him and the ministry access, God, into doors that have always been closed. So that, God, they can go in and find the information they need to be able to hand over to law enforcement, that these places can get shut down, and these women and children can find freedom and restoration and wholeness through you. So God, we thank you for this opportunity. I pray you bless both the giver and the gift this morning. I pray you take it and you multiply it. God, use it to advance this ministry and advance your kingdom all around the world. And so we just thank you so much for this opportunity this morning. We love you and we just adore you. In Jesus' name, amen. And so if you're here with us this morning and you'd like to give towards Caleb and the ministry, I pray you just place it in a basket up here following service. If you're online again, www.chismag.com, click the Give tab, and you can select guest speaker right in there and donate. And everything that comes in is going to go directly to Caleb and to the ministry there. And so we so appreciate your heart, your generosity, and just your obedience to God's leading in the area of tithes and finances. And so I just want to say thank you for being here with us today. Thank you for joining us online. We're looking forward to continuing to join together here in person. And so, but we pray you have a wonderful week, and God bless. Thank you so much for being here with us today.